Thanks a lot. Also, thank you for the invitation. So, right. I'm a PhD student at the Technical University of Vienna for 2 years now, under the supervision of Robert Gagnon. And what I want to show you today is work that is based on two papers that you have. So the first one of which appeared at ICALP this year, and the second one with the second set of co-authors we are preparing for submission at the moment. And this work describes a technique to get fixed parameter algorithms for graph drawing extension problems. Let me start by introducing some graph drawing related terminology. So a drawing of a graph just maps its vertices to points in the Euclidean plane and its edges to simple curves between them. So here, for example, you can see four drawings of the K2-3. It is quite standard to make some additional assumptions on drawings, for example, that edges don't intersect, or drawings of edges don't intersect in non-zero measure sets. So parts of edge drawings don't overlap, like here, for example. And also, one typically assumes that no three edges intersect in a single point. So this excludes drawings like the rightmost one here. And another very standard assumption that one makes is that of drawings being simple. I want to emphasize this here because it is a bit more in the spotlight as a standard assumption for our work. So a drawing is called simple if no pair of edges intersects in more than one point. So for example, if you look at this drawing again here, you can see that these two edges here intersect in their shared endpoint and in another point. So this drawing is also not simple. The probably most studied aspect of drawings are their crossings, which are just non-endpoint intersections of edges. So here I have marked all the crossings in the drawings here. And probably you all know that a drawing is called planar if it has no crossings. This is the case for the second drawing here. And as a last kind of vocabulary term, drawing subdivides the Euclidean plane into inclusion maximal connected subsets, which are called cells. So if you're aware, in planar drawings, one typically calls them faces, but for drawings that are not necessarily planar, one calls them cells. So I have marked examples of cells in each of these drawings. In particular, there's always an unbounded cell, which is also called the outer cell of a drawing. What we want to look at now are drawing extension problems, where you have a partial drawing of a graph from which some edges and vertices are missing, and you want to insert drawings of these edges and vertices into the given drawing without changing that initial drawing. So that's basically the type of problem we want to look at. And of course, it makes sense to restrict how you draw the additional vertices and edges into the given drawing. So this has applications, of course, if you want to visualize networks or something like that, anything that you can draw as a graph into which more information is added over time, or you want to allow a user to specify some fixed drawing of parts of a graph which have to be drawn in that way, and then to draw additional information on top of that. But also, probably this just on an intuitive level makes sense to want to find drawings of graphs with few crossings in total. And also then drawing extension problems pop up, because a common approach to do this is to find a large subgraph which you can draw in a planar way, and then to insert what's missing without creating too many crossings. So drawing extension problems are quite well motivated and studied, and that's it's not surprising that there is quite a bit of literature on them. The probably most important result is that if you want to insert edges and vertices, and these new edges and vertices are not allowed to create additional crossings, this can be done in linear time. This is also called planar drawing extension. But this positive result is really one of the only ones there is, because if you even want to relax the restrictions you put on your additional edge drawings even a tiny bit by allowing them to cross, but at most once per added edge, this is already NP-hard. And this is NP-hard because it is NP-hard to recognize graphs that you can draw with one drawing per edge. Those are called one planar graphs. And here, the hardness reduction is basically based on the fact that you can formulate the drawing problem or the recognition problem as an extension problem, which is maybe a bit unfair, because this is then not a problem or not the complexity of the extension really, but of the recognition. And a hardness result that is kind of dual to this one here is okay, if it's hard because I can draw a whole complete graph, what happens if I restrict the size of what is missing? So what, for example, happens if I want to insert only one edge? Well, this is inserting only one edge without restricting its number of crossings, but having the additional restriction that you don't want it to cross the same old edge twice is also NP-hard, which is maybe quite surprising. And these will be the most important hardness results for this presentation here. Of course, other things have been studied as well. In particular, you can also go in the other direction. So from this positive insertion result, you can also go in the direction, okay, I don't want to relax the restrictions I have on the edges I insert, but I want to have more specific conditions for them. But there also, across the board, you get NP hardness so far. As I already indicated, we want to focus on these two hardness results. So inserting one edge without creating more than one crossing per added edge is NP-hard. And as a dual thing, kind of, if you insert only one edge in a simple way, this is also NP-hard. So if you think about parameterized complexity, then it makes sense to look for parametrizations which include both the number of crossings per added edge as well as the number of edges you insert. So for those of you who are not familiar with parameterized complexity, here we are looking at an algorithmic result. So we want to find some parameter which, if that is small, then we get polynomial runtime, and it of course might depend exponentially on the parameter that we choose. So, but these two hardnesses really show us that we need to combine the number of crossings per edge and the number of edges we want to insert if we want to go in this direction. And what we have in these two papers is actually that simple, or if you drop the restriction of simplicity, then it's just then the problem becomes a bit easier. But the results we have from our two papers is that even if you restrict the edges, the new edges, to be inserted in a simple way, that then you can get an FPT algorithm parameterized by the number of times a new edge is allowed to cross and the number of new edges you insert. And the ideas I want to show you are about this. What we do basically is rooted in the observation that we can somehow find a small part, or not small, but well-structured part of our initial drawing, which is interesting for us, and the rest is somehow, in some sense, irrelevant. What do I mean by that? So imagine that you have some initial drawing here, and your missing part links to certain vertices which are already drawn. Either these are endpoints of missing edges, or these are basically endpoints of missing edges which are already drawn. Of course, you might have missing edges that have no endpoints that are already drawn, but at some point they will connect to endpoints which are already drawn via other missing edges. And the thing is that if you assume this situation, then if you have some large obstruction here, so some a lot of edges which are drawn here that separate this inner part from this outer part, you will not be able to reach, for example, this cell with anything missing without crossing a lot of things here. So in some sense, we can delete the parts of the initial drawing which are far away from the already drawn neighbors or endpoints of missing edges. And in that way, we will be able to planarize and arrive at a graph of bounded diameter that is also planar and by some known results then has bounded tree width. This is basically the observation that allows us to get a handle on the drawing extension problem. So how do we want to use this? Well, we'll apply a bit of a hammer here. We'll use Courcelles theorem. And for those of you that don't know it, I'll give a quick overview over the version that we use. If you have a graph, and that graph can be labeled, so vertices and edges of the graph can be labeled. Sorry, that's a mistake on the slide. If you have a graph that is labeled and an MSO2 formula, I'll explain what an MSO2 formula looks like a bit later, then you can find a satisfying assignment of the free variables of that formula or decide that there is no satisfying assignment in fixed parameter tractable time parametrized by the tree width of the graph and the size of the formula or the length of the formula. And again, fixed parameter tractability means that if you consider the tree width of the graph and the length of the formula as constants, then you will have polynomial running time and the degree of the polynomial does not depend on these two parameters. In this case, even it is linear. Right, so how do we want to use this? Well, from our initial drawing, we will want to derive a combinatorial graph with bounded tree width that contains all relevant information of the initial drawing. And this will correspond to the graph G we want to apply Courcelles on. And then we want to encode what it means to be a solution for the drawing extension problem in this combinatorial graph structure as an MSO2 formula. And from this, we will get an FPT algorithm using Courcelles. So again, the combinatorial, we want to find a combinatorialization of our initial drawing, which will correspond to this G we apply a cosine for, and to encode the fact that something is a solution in this combinatorial graph structure as an MSO2 formula. So in the following slides, I've also color-coded titles a little bit, so you see what part I'm trying to give you an overview over. So let's start by deriving a combinatorial structure from the initial drawing. Of course, I'm going to present everything on a high level only, but something I want to point out is that from a combinatorial point of view, the drawing of an edge is determined by relatively few things. So of course, it's determined by its endpoints and any points where it crosses. And points being, okay, we don't care about shifting around too much, but it's important what edge segments it crosses, kind of. But even once you know that, there are different ways of drawing edges in the terms of what vertices they separate from each other. So for example, if you consider these first two drawings, they essentially really do the same thing because they separate the same vertices from each other in the sense that another crossing has to be made to reach this vertex from this vertex. So either the new orange edge will be crossed or this edge here, necessarily. In this sense, these two drawings are the same, but for example, this third drawing is different because here one could add a drawing between these two vertices without creating any crossing. And this fourth option is yet another different way of drawing the edge. So this is just to provide some intuition on construction we'll do now. So we will derive an embedding graph of a drawing in which we look at this cell in the initial drawing we have. And of course, we keep all vertices and edges, but we also subdivide in the edges that we can still cross just to have a combinatorial handle on them, like really explicitly. And we introduce a cell vertex for each cell, just because we want to be able to connect different edge segments without going through the other ones. Also, if we don't add cell vertices, we won't necessarily have bounded diameter, because what will happen is that we connect everything on the boundary of a cell to that cell vertex via short paths. And thus one can shortcut traversing through cells through the cell vertex, whereas without the cell vertex, vertices on the boundary of the same cell might actually have quite large distance. And now, because of what I showed you on the earlier slide, we want to traverse the boundary of a cell and create copies for what we encounter, or all the relevant vertices that we encounter on the cell boundary. In that way, in particular, multiple shadow copies of original vertices can be made. And this is exactly to distinguish whether I access this vertex here from this side. So for example, from this edge to here would separate this vertex, whereas accessing it from this side, so from here to here, does not separate the shadow copy. And this is really just a combinatorialization of it. So because we distinguish where it occurs in the order of other vertices. And finally, we connect everything in a way that makes sense. So in a way that shadows can be used as access points for the original vertices or edge vertices we care about. And in a way that, as I said, you can basically shortcut or connect shadow vertices of a cell through the cell vertex. And then if you then delete things at large distance, which you cannot access with few crossings, then you will arrive at an obviously planar graph. So you planarize this. This means you insert an auxiliary vertex here, a dummy vertex, and then you'll arrive at a planar graph of bounded diameter and hence bounded tree width. Turning to encoding what a solution or being an extension in this combinatorial graph structure means, I just want to give you a quick overview of monadic second order logic. So we are using MSO2 here. In MSO2, you are allowed to have vertex variables and edge variables, variables for vertex sets and edge sets. And you can quantify over these variables, as well as describe that a vertex or edge is contained in a vertex set or edge set, that vertices or edges are equal, that vertex sets of edge sets are equal, that a vertex is incident to some edge. And of course, you can check equality for your constantly many labels that you have on the vertices and edges. So for example, you can encode the existence of an ST path of arbitrary length by a constant length formula. And I'll quickly show you how you do that. So you have a variable E that is supposed to be the edge set of the path, of the ST path, of the hypothetical ST path that exists. And how do you encode that E is really the edge set of an ST path? Well, you want a vertex on this ST path to be S, to be T, you want any vertex to be S or T, or not to be incident to any edge on this ST path, or to two edges. So you have the endpoints, or an inner point, which is incident to two edges of the ST path, or it's not involved in the ST path at all. And for the endpoints, you want them definitely to be included and to be incident to exactly one edge from the ST path. So that's basically how an exemplary encoding of a natural property in MSO2 looks like. So here is the point where I skip a lot of details. What you do to encode solutions in MSO2 is you have variables for every cell vertex that corresponds to a cell into which you draw in your solution you're looking for, so in your drawing extension. And these will be boundedly many just because you have few edges and each of them can cross into few cells. And for each cell we draw into, we will also have three variables that represent important incidents on the boundary of that respective cell. So for example, there will be a free variable for a vertex where an added edge crosses an edge on the boundary of that cell. And the property of this you have is that there be that there'll be a bounded number of configurations for these three variables, and you can apply Courcelles' theorem to each of them to check compatibility with the combinatorialization of the drawing that we have constructed, so that I have explained to you before. So basically what you do is you say, for example, I have four cells into which my missing parts will be drawn, and I don't know exactly what they look like, but I know, for example, that in this third cell here, parts of two missing edges will be drawn like this. In particular, they will cross, because they will like the points where they cross into this third cell will alternate on the boundary of that third cell. And then what you can encode in MS02 is that these configurations actually are compatible with the initial drawing, or more precisely with the embedding graph you construct. So this is basically what you do in general. Of course, some adaptations have to be made to include simplicity, or the simplicity condition on added edges. So what you can do with what I have shown you so far is restrict the number of times each added edge crosses and make sure that the added edges connect the correct endpoints and stuff like that. But you still have the problem that you might have this new edge, so this orange thing, and some original edge which you cross multiple times. And there are two problems here, actually. One is quite simply solved. So of course you can't mark each vertex that arises from the same edge with the same label, because you only want a constant number of labels. But what you can do is to have sensible label at every time at crossing points with other original edges that basically allow you to follow the same edge throughout, and then you can encode the fact that a drawing of a new edge crosses the same original edge, and then disallow that by saying there is a path consisting of edge vertices which have which at each crossing point follow this labeling in a way that tells you, okay, this is the same edge. What is more difficult is that so I told you to keep the diameter small, as one of the first things you do is to delete things at large distance so that you can't cross into really. And in this way, you might actually disconnect original edges in your initial drawing, and there's really no way of identifying them anymore. And this basically has to be stitched back together. And you have to show that you can do it in a way without increasing the tree width too much. I'm not going to go into details here, because that's actually quite a bit of work. But that's basically the idea, to reintroduce some connections here. So to conclude, that's basically a very powerful technique with which one can get FPT algorithms parameterized by the number of edges one inserts and the number of crossings. And one can also encode additional restrictions on the inserted drawings one wants to have, such as, for example, simplicity. What is a lot more difficult, or where this technique doesn't seem to extend, is if you want to parametrize by deletion distance, not only of edges, but also of vertices from the complete graph to the graph you have already drawn. So what do I mean by this? For example, here, in this initial, in this drawing, the initial drawing is black and the missing things are orange as usual, then you would have large deletion distance from the whole thing to the black thing in terms of edges, but you would need have deletion distance only one if you allowed to delete vertices. And this parametrization obviously makes a lot of sense. But the problem we have now is that you might draw into many cells compared to your parameter. So you can draw into arbitrarily many cells and have only one inserted vertex, only one new vertex, which means somehow our solution encoding doesn't work out anymore at all. What we do get FBT for this more restrictive parametrization for is so-called independent crossing planar drawing extension. Again, won't go into details here. And we don't know that one planar, so you allow each new edge to cross one other edge. Drawing extension is XP, so polynomial time in particular, if you assume the number of missing vertices and independent missing edges to be constant. But the degree of this polynomial depends on the parameters. What's also interesting is using these techniques for choosing edges to insert from a set of options. So I give you a set of edges which I might want to insert, insert many of them. So that's also an interesting direction in which one could think about using similar techniques. Yeah, and this basically concludes my presentation. The main open question I would share with you is that we really don't know what to do for the more restrictive parametrization. Thank you.
Okay, many thanks. I think we can unmute ourselves and then clap for you. Okay, are there any questions related to this work for Tekla? I mean, I would have quite a natural question. Have you thought about extending this this approach to graphs that are embedded in some higher order surfaces, like?
Not yet. No, not at all yet. So we haven't thought about that. But as long as you can somehow get to this bounded tree width part, which yep. should be possible if you're on surfaces, that's mm-hmm. okay. But if you go into more dimensions and allow connections across more dimensions, I don't see it like easily extending.
Yeah, that's a pity. Okay, any other questions? Okay. Doesn't.
Maybe. Yeah, so this is like all in this present was like measuring the number of crossings. Is anything known if you just measure how many edges you cross and don't measure how many times you cross them?
Let me think one second if I get the question correctly. So you're asking, I don't restrict the number of crossings I create per added edge, but I restrict the number of original edges that I cross?
Yes, for example.
So I'm not aware of anything. I wouldn't be sure that that is NP hard. I'm not sure about that. Because if you're allowed to interesting. I haven't thought about it. So I don't want to say anything wrong now. I don't know any result that immediately implies NP hardness. If you have few of those, so okay, but also your question allows like considering only that as a parameter. Maybe that makes sense. Not sure. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks.
Okay, so thanks a lot for your talk and interesting answers to our questions, our tricky questions in case of Andrea. We will really